OK, the next item of business is a debate on motion 7852 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on International Day of Women and Girls in Science. I would invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I call on the Minister to speak to and move the motion around 10 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, President Officer, and allow me to move the motion in my name at this stage, lest I forget to do so later. President Officer, in 2015, the United Nations adopted a resolution to designate the 11th of February as the International Day of Women and Girls in Science. Since then, this day has become an annual celebration of the achievements of women and girls in science. But it also serves as a reminder that women and girls remain underrepresented in many areas of science, and we should commend the many organisations across Scotland that are playing a part in seeking to address that issue. STEM, science, technology, engineering and mathematics has, of course, traditionally been a male-dominated sector. And though women have made tremendous progress in this area, a significant gender gap sadly still persists. For that reason, the United Nations drive to establish an annual day dedicated to recognising the incredible contributions that women play in the STEM sector was in itself an important milestone. Since then, on the 11th of February every year, countries around the world, including Scotland, mark this important day. And that's the reason for this debate, and I look forward to hearing insights from other members over the course of this afternoon.
Absolutely.
Stephen Kerr.
The Minister is making a very valid point about the disproportionate underrepresentation of women in certain areas, career and sector areas. Has any analysis been done on the number of apprenticeships in those particular sectors that the Minister has in mind in terms of the representation of women?
Minister.
Yes, there has, and I don't have the figures to hand right now. I'd be very happy to write to Mr Kerr to provide those details. Sadly, we see replicated as in colleges, universities and in the wider labour market, gender segregation in the apprenticeship frameworks that we have. There has been progress, and I'm sure Mr Kerr, like other members, would welcome that. There is activity underway. There is an Equalities Action Plan that's in place through Skills Development Scotland, and the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board have made a series of recommendations specifically looking at gender that was provided at the end of last year, and we're currently considering how to respond to that. But I'll be happy to write to Mr Kerr with some more information. So, let me begin by reflecting some of Scotland's own pioneers in the STEM sector. For more than a century, Scottish women have not only played influential roles in the industry itself, but also helped provide the funding and infrastructure necessary to allow other women to progress. The mathematician, astronomer and scientist Mary Somerville was dubbed the queen of 19th century science on her death in 1872. Her books were bestsellers, and such was her standing. Hers was the first signature on John Stuart Mill's petition to Parliament calling for votes for women. Mary Somerville holds the distinction of being the first female scientist featured on a British banknote following a public vote. In the field of medicine, the Edinburgh Seven were trailblazers as the first group of matriculated undergraduate female students at not just any Scottish university, but any British university. They began studying medicine at the University of Edinburgh in 1869, and all scandalously, they were ultimately prevented from graduating and qualifying as doctors. The campaign they fought gained national attention and won them many supporters, and ultimately it led to a change in legislation to ensure that women could be licensed to practice medicine in 1876, and legislation to ensure that women could study at university. Women were able to graduate from the University of Edinburgh from 1894, and the first female doctors graduated in 1896. Victoria Drummond of Perthshire was the first woman marine engineer in the UK and the first woman member of the Institute of Marine Engineers. In the Second World War, she served at sea as an engineering officer in the Merchant Navy and was recognised for bravery at sea under enemy fire. She was inducted into the Scottish Engineering Hall of Fame in 2018. President Officer, it's important that we recognise, mark and celebrate that lineage, but just as important, maybe more important, lest we fall foul of thinking of Scotland's scientific achievements and endeavours only in the past tense, that we have to recognise and celebrate what is happening today. Scotland has some incredible women making groundbreaking discoveries here and now. There are many examples I could give, and I hope to hear that over the course of today's debate, but I want to highlight just a few. Professor Ellen Kashefi was appointed as National Quantum Computing Centre Chief Scientist in November 2022 and leads Edinburgh University's Quantum Software Lab. Professor Catherine Haymans of the University of Edinburgh became the first woman to be appointed as Scotland's Astronomer Royal in May 2021. She's best known for her work on using the technique of cosmic weak gravitational lensing to learn more about the universe. Professor Sheila Rowan from the University of Glasgow became the president of the UK Institute of Physics in October 2021. She's part of the international research collaboration that first detected the existence of gravitational waves, opening up new ways to understand our universe. She was also chief scientific advisor for Scotland from 2016 to 2021. Professor Rebecca Goss at the University of St Andrews is achieving great strides in the field of chemical synthesis using biotechnology. In 2022, she spun out Exgenix, a biotech startup with the goal of enabling discovery of better drugs for better health globally. They received £2 million of investment to translate the technology and were recognised through winning first place in Converge 2022, Scotland's top spin-out competition, with a prize of £69,000. And within the Scottish Government, Scotland's chief scientific advisor is Professor Julie Fitzpatrick, a veterinary surgeon by training. Julie champions science and evidence at the heart of Scottish Government policymaking and is spearheading a range of activities in support of this. And I can say, as a Minister for Science, is an invaluable source of support to me. Yes?
Pam Gosling.
I thank the member for taking that intervention. Does the member also agree that there is less, there's underrepresentation from the BAME community for women and girls, but also some of the names that you're mentioning as well? And is there any data that you have around that?
Minister.
Yes, again, we will have that information. Much of in the same vein as my response to Mr Kerr. If we look at apprenticeships, specifically the Equalities Action Plan that SDS is working to, gender is only one of the characteristics that we know we need to make progress in relation to. So, yes, we will have that information, and again, I'm very happy to provide that in detail to the member. For all of the outstanding achievements that we will rightly recognise today and has been pointed out and alluded to already, we know that there is much more to be done. Many of our learned institutions are carrying out important work to understand the issues, including the Institute of Physics and the Royal Society of Chemistry. And allow me to recognise the role of the RSC's first female president, appointed in 2012, Professor Leslie Yellowlees of the University of Edinburgh, in championing this. They produced a number of reports over the last few years to highlight the issues involved, including recruitment, retention, promotion, research culture, and pay and reward. Crucially, they also suggest ways to address the underrepresentation of women in science, some of which involve tackling deep-seated problems around inequalities. For many years now, Scotland has championed the importance of women in the STEM sector as part of our wider efforts to address the issue of gender inequality, which sits at the heart of our vision for an equal Scotland. Tackling gender inequality across different areas of the education and learning landscape is fundamental to changing perceptions about STEM and challenging assumptions about who does what in relation to gender and wider inequalities. At the same time, STEM is integral to Scotland's future economic and social development, and the Scottish Government wants everyone in Scotland to build a strong foundation of STEM skills and knowledge. Bring this together, the Developing Young Workforce Strategy includes specific actions around promoting career options to different protected groups, designing senior phase vocational pathways to improve gender balance, reducing occupational segregation and modern apprenticeships, and embedding equality across the curriculum for excellence. Recognising that assumption about which gender undertakes which subject matter or pursues which career, it starts early, and I was delighted to be at Dundee Science Centre as part of Dundee Science Festival, where I met a group of enthusiastic young people from Rosebank Primary School, and the girls in attendance engaged in the activities underway.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Minister for taking this intervention. I hear what he's saying about encouragement of girls even in primary school, but to my mind it could indeed even start from that. For example, creating specialist teaching materials for nurseries that are geared specifically towards girls' engagement in science. Is that something he might agree with?
Minister.
Yeah, we're always keen to do what we can to make sure that we're starting to engage as early as possible with young people, particularly young girls, to make sure that we are tackling these challenges. And I know that there is activity underway in the early years and learning sector, and that is something I would commend and be keen to see more of. Other areas of activity that we are supporting, President Officer, include funding for Equate Scotland to support recruitment, retention, return and success of women into jobs where they are significantly underrepresented. Funding is also provided to CareerWise, which offers female undergraduates paid work placements with STEM employers, and each college has measures in place to help reduce gender disparities within STEM subject areas. The ambition is that by 2030, no college or university subject will have a gender imbalance greater than 75% of one gender. As the International Day of Girls and Women in Science demonstrates, collective action is needed. I've highlighted some of the activity underway, but I've framed the motion today in terms in which I think we will unite around, and that it isn't just government that has to make this effort, it's all of us collectively as publicly elected representatives. So I hope we will support the motion today. I can say to members, we will be supporting both amendments, and I look forward to hearing what members have to say.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now call on Pam Gosel to speak to and move amendment 7852.2 for around 7 minutes, Ms Gosel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be opening today's debate for the Scottish Conservatives, which marks International Day of Women and Girls in Science. As Shadow Minister for the Higher and Further Education, Youth Employment and Training, and an advocate for women reaching their full potential, I move the amendment in my name. In the words of Marie Curie, be less curious about people and more curious about ideas. For a long time, women's contribution in science was hidden or discredited, and this is well articulated in the University of Glasgow Women in STEM blog. Challenges for women in science in the past and present have built a sense of camaraderie among female scientists to ensure that this does not determine the future. I'm extremely impressed by the efforts of many institutions and grassroots groups across Scotland and around the world to tackle the gender gap and make science an accessible, attractive career for young women, to name a few that are close to home. I admire the work being done by Fem Eng at Glasgow University to encourage girls at school to seriously get involved and consider a future in science. They have collaborated with the University of Rwanda and of Malawi to inspire young budding female scientists in school. The University West of Scotland in my region have also made tremendous steps to increase female participation in science, with more than 2,000 new female science undergraduates in each of the last 3 years. With nearly 30% of women in science subjects coming from 20% of the most deprived areas in Scotland, and supporting more than four-fifths of women in science graduates in employment or further education in the first 18 months. The University of West of Scotland also boasts some tremendous scientific contributions by female scientists, such as that of Professor Fiona Hercrix, the woman behind the team who developed the world's first treatment for a devastating eye condition which affects millions of people every year, or Maria Nakrasova, a chemistry student who was enabled by UWS to go to the Kennedy Space Center in Florida to watch her experiment launch into orbit on SpaceX CRS-26. Most recently, I visited the British Heart Foundation's Research Excellence Center at University of Glasgow and was overcome by the work being done there. I was introduced to 6 students, from which 4 whom were young women. It is difficult to put into words the immense impact their research will have. One excellent example is that of Caitlin Cosgrove, who is trying to identify microRNAs that may be beneficial in strokes, which in the future may be inserted to target bad cells in the brain. I would like to thank the Royal Society of Chemistry for their briefing, which sets out how addressing gaps in data, funding and flexibility will help enable the equal participation of those from underrepresented groups. In addition to this, increasing accountability and eliminating bias will go a long way in building cultures of belonging. I am happy to support the Government's motion today, which speaks about the importance of women to Scotland's world-leading science and research sector. Likewise, the Labour amendment makes some important points about how gender inequality in STEM begins from a young age. But there are areas where the Government motion could have gone further, as my own amendment sets out. My amendment speaks about the importance of inclusion and of ensuring no woman feels unable to enter the STEM sector because of their gender, ethnicity or disability. As we recognise the International Day of Women and Girls in Science, it is important that we celebrate the contributions of women in all their diversity. I therefore hope that members across the chamber will be able to support my amendment today. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, whilst we celebrate International Day of Women and Girls in Science, it is clear that there is more to be done to ensure that STEM is accessible to all. This means addressing the root causes of the inequalities that exist at all levels, ensuring schools are able to tackle this inequality from a young age, and recognising that unlocking the talent of women in all their diversities is the key to empowering our science sector. While great work is underway on the ground by universities, colleges and grassroots groups, they cannot do this alone. It is therefore the duty of all the members in this chamber to work together to find a solution and to work towards eliminating any remaining barriers for good.
Thank you very much, Ms Gosling. I now call on Michael Mara to speak to move amendment 7852.1 for around 5 minutes. Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name. Across the long stretch of our written history, the achievements of women in science have been neglected, or worse still, subsumed into the achievements of their male counterparts. Professor Dame Jocelyn Bell Burnell is an astrophysicist, best known today for her discovery of radio pulsars in 1967, one of the great astronomical discoveries of the 20th century. But when the Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded in 1974 for her discovery, Bell Burnell was not one of the recipients. Two men were honoured instead. The light of Dame Jocelyn's brilliance could yet not be dimmed, nor remain hidden by the cumulative millennia of patriarchy and misogyny. She has since become the first female president of the Royal Society of Edinburgh and is now Chancellor of the University of Dundee. Progress, wherever it is found, should always be welcomed. I've personally, Presiding Officer, been privileged to work under outstanding female academic leaders, Professor Georgina Follett, Professor Dame Sue Black, Professor Niamh McDade, extraordinary leaders in their fields in this country of design, forensic anthropology and forensic science. And there are a whole new generation of female academic leaders in Scotland who are transforming and inspiring through our great universities. Professor Claire Bond in Earth Science at Net Zero at the University of Aberdeen, Professor Natalie Cool in Cybersecurity at Abertay, and so many, many more. However, such examples are of those who have successfully navigated what is termed the leaky pipeline of talent, whereby many women and girls do not continue in STEM subjects at university or beyond into STEM careers. Data published by the RSE shows that over 70% of women STEM graduates leave STEM-related careers. Athena Swan programmes are helping. We are adopted and invested, but the pandemic has been a further setback for the careers of women who carry the burden of care. But unfortunately, again, the loss of girls from STEM begins much earlier. And that's reflected in subject uptake statistics, which remain woefully unequal. In 2021, only 20% of National 5 chemistry candidates were female. And whatever the Scottish Government may tell us, interventions in this area have had no discernible impact. The percentage of female candidates for National 5 chemistry is unchanged for years, and National 5 physics has only inched from 28% to 29% over the course of the last 3 years. These statistics are hardly cause for celebration or self-congratulation. We know that we also have a dire lack of STEM teachers in schools, that those taking STEM subjects to senior levels is plummeting in number. Yes, sir.
Stephen Kerr.
I'm grateful to Michael Mara for giving way. He's giving an excellent speech. part of the problem, of course, is recruiting STEM teachers. Would he be open to consideration of ways of broadening the routes into STEM teaching that might encourage a greater uptake and interest, particularly for people perhaps who are later on in their careers who have so much to give and to give back, particularly to young women?
Michael Mara, I can give you the time.
I think such ideas that Mr Kerr puts forward are certainly worthy of consideration. I think, in fact, it's an imperative that we take new and innovative ways of getting people into our STEM classrooms to make sure that we make good on that shortfall. And I would point out, particularly in computing science, which frankly is an unfolding disaster, with a curriculum in dire need of revision and schools priced out of the marketplace for those to teach it. And that's at a time when the economy desperately needs more of all of this knowledge rather than less. But our job here, as Mr Kerr, I think, points out, is not to be commentators, but to make change. And an important area of STEM that desperately needs more women is in our tech industry. The ONS show that only 23.4% of the tech industry workforce in Scotland is female. Last night, Polly McNeill, MSP, and I hosted a roundtable on violence against women and girls here in Parliament. And the proliferation of misogynistic content online, the impact this is having on our culture, and the consequential rising tide of violence against women and girls is abundantly clear. A better gender balance in the technology workforce, where products are conceived and designed, must be part of that solution. And risks are better understood, where gender design can prevent harm and a better culture can be led. Professor Leslie Yellowlee's advice paper on diversity in STEM for the Royal Society of Edinburgh calls on this government to lead the way by using the powers and influence that they do have now to shape societal attitudes to gender equality, parental roles, and crucially, to targeting critical influencers of children and young people to challenge gender stereotypes. That's showing leadership, and it's leadership demonstrated by having women in position. And the report also calls for greater investment in STEM-specific data collection in order to better understand intersectionality and variations across sectors and regions. I would ask the Minister to give consideration to those calls in his own remarks, in his closing remarks today. Rather than resigning ourselves to be narrators of these events, I urge the Scottish Government to take all of those recommendations from the RSE and to do all in their power to implement them.
Thank you very much, Mr Mara. I now call on Willie Rennie for around 4 minutes, Mr Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. When I was at school making my choices for fourth year, my mother accompanied me to meet Mr Hayward. And I was keen at that time to abandon maths. I was bored with maths. I'd had enough of maths, probably tells now. I was in charge of the finances in the party. But nevertheless, I was determined to get rid of, to abandon maths. But Mr Hayward repeatedly said that maths was a must for boys. And my mother's face went brighter red the more he said it. She was, even at that stage, incandescent with the discrimination that was inbuilt within the careers advice at our school. And that's evident ever since. We've seen it before that and after that. It's very clear. I mean, today, physics, we're told by the Institute of Physics, is the fourth most popular subject for boys. For girls, it's the 16th. So there is something still wrong at the heart of our society and perhaps within our careers advice. And it's no wonder sometimes that maybe women don't want to choose those subjects. If they're going to be the only girl, the only woman in the class, why would you do that? We know that in politics, that if you think you're going to be the only person in the room like you, why would you go into those subjects? So it's important, if we're going to get change, we need to start that change now. Thankfully, it is a little bit better now. But we've seen through the careers that in chemistry, in higher chemistry, half those sitting the subject, according to the RSE, are female. In advanced higher, it goes up a little bit more, which is good. In university, when they're studying for a degree in chemistry, it goes up to 60%, and then it absolutely plummets. It's 9% when it becomes a professor. That's a clear indication that we've got something wrong with the career path in science as well. The higher up you go, the less likely you're going to have women. Certainly.
Pam Gosell.
Taking that intervention. Does the member believe that parents have an important role to play as well? When you talked about your mother going red there, that parents should be playing an important role in the change to happen. And do you think the government need to include, obviously, parents in the programmes that they're working on at the moment?
Through the chair, Willie Rennie, and I can give you the time back.
Yes, of course, and parents are an important factor. I mean, we've had discussions recently about, and this is where Stephen Kerr's point comes in, about apprenticeships. Trying to get people more to do apprenticeships rather than going through the university route is a real challenge, and a lot of that is down to parental, society influence, peer pressure. And it's the same in this as well. I mean, Stephen Kerr asked the Minister for some figures. 38% of those who take modern apprenticeships are female. That goes down to 8% for engineering and energy. Dramatic difference. Again, inbuilt discrimination within the system. So we do need to change this. And part of all of this is about society pressure, about parents, about schools, all of that. So what do we do? What are the steps that we take? Now, there's good projects like that CERC run with the STEM ambassadors that allow people like my wife, who goes out into, she's a scientist, she goes out into schools and tries to encourage young women and men to take up science. So that's important. They try to get a million interactions with young people. But there's also something we can do in policy. It's great that, I think, great credit to the government, that the last few scientific advisers have been female. Anne Glover was fantastic. She was a great advocate, went off to Europe, did the same role there. Julie Fitzpatrick doing a great job now too. We also need to call out the discrimination, as Michael Marra has done earlier. But we can perhaps use funding to incentivise organisations to have plans in place and take steps to encourage more women into all these subjects. Perhaps make some requirements, just like we do for Amazon and the likes in terms of apprenticeships, in terms of paying their tax, in terms of paying the living wage. Perhaps we should use funding to incentivise organisations to make this change. And my final point is Education Scotland have got a great programme, which I think the Minister referred to, which is Improving Gender Balance and Equalities programme. Now, with Education Scotland changing, I hope that programme will continue, because it's important that if something is working, that it's allowed to continue to do that good work.
Thank you very much, Mr Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I call first Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Liz Smith. Around 4 minutes, Ms Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today we commend International Day of Women and Girls in Science. Women are indeed a pioneering and unique body within the sciences, and yet despite this, remain underrepresented. Earlier this week, I met Professor Linda Lawton of the Robert Gordon University to discuss women and girls in STEM as part of my preparation for our members' debate. An internationally renowned researcher in the field of toxic cyanobacteria, Professor Lawton perhaps summed it up when she said, "Well, it doesn't help that if you Google the word professor, you get a picture of a man with white hair wearing glasses." She was wrong. I got a complete screen full of men and only men. The last decade or so has seen progress for girls and women in STEM education, but also for women entering the STEM workforce. It is a slow burn, but absolutely essential if we are to tackle our climate emergency. And I want to highlight two examples of the work underpinning this trend in the North East, one in education and the other industry-led. The Aberdeen Computing Collaborative is a collaboration between Aberdeen City Council, North East Scotland College, the Robert Gordon University and the University of Aberdeen, seeking to improve alignment between the school curriculum and the associated demand for the skills created by the next phase in our energy production and other growth sectors. And I note the reference in Michael Marra's amendment in this regard. But it also aims to increase the profile of computing science learning and attract graduates into computer science and within that, teaching. So this fantastic initiative aligns with the Scottish Government's STEM education and training strategy that outlines our ambition to encourage girls and young women to engage with computing science with a view to strengthening Scotland's future tech sector. So it was therefore bitterly disappointing that a recent Just Transition funding bid to support the collaborative was unsuccessful. And I would ask the Minister to provide an assurance that comprehensive feedback and advice will be provided in order to inform and support future successful applications. Turning to industry, Girls in Energy is a one-year course delivered by Shell in partnership with the North East Scotland College and Fife College to senior phase girls, helping them to rethink preconceptions about the energy sector and hear about the range of careers available in energy. And I recently joined this year's cohort of around 100 girls in Aberdeen, and I was blown away by the way that they worked together to find innovative solutions to food production, heating and energy-related challenges. Teams were...
It's actually an earlier point. I'm wondering if the member agrees that to facilitate more science, maths and technology specialists to engage as speakers in schools, that one possible initiative is to support the creation of national or indeed regional women in STEM speaker lists of those who are willing to evangelise and help bring other girls and women into the professions.
Audrey Nicola, and give you the time.
I thank Michelle Thompson for her intervention. I think she's been reading my notes over my shoulder because I completely agree with that. In fact, I'm just going to come on to something that may be relevant to that. The judging panel in Girls in Energy comprised strong local female role models already in senior positions in the North East tech and energy sectors, and I know from my conversations with many of them how committed they are to this vitally important work, and I suspect that many of them would be very interested in Michelle Thompson's proposal. So, Presiding Officer, there are of course many challenges in the gendered world we live in, culture, mentoring opportunities and funding. But today is about celebration, and I hope that this short contribution on International Day of Women and Girls in Science has showcased a snippet of what is happening on the ground in this exciting sphere. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Nicola. And I call Liz Smith to be followed by Co-Cab Stewart. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And the Minister, in his opening remarks, referred to the Edinburgh Seven. And had we been debating this 150 years ago, we would have been debating the front page of the Scotsman newspaper that referred to the riot at Surgeons Hall just a mile from here, when these female undergraduates were prevented from getting into their examination hall. And the crowds that had turned up were pelting them with all kinds of rubbish, screaming abuse at them and doing all sorts to make sure that they couldn't actually sit the exam. Now, some of their male compatriots came to their rescue and ensured that they could get into the examination hall. But even inside that examination hall, some other males prevented them from sitting at the desk. And rumour has it that a live sheep was set loose in the hall. Goodness knows how they got it in, but they did. And absolute chaos, and to the extent that it made the front pages of international news, and these Edinburgh Seven, who are pioneers in their field, ended up being put in touch with Charles Darwin. So it just shows what can happen. Now, there's some really interesting things being said already in this debate. Willie Rennie referred to the advice that he was given at school. I was told at school that I should be doing science, and I was told that economics was not for girls. Well, that didn't work very well because obviously I became an economist. I didn't do science, but one of the things that I've come to understand both as a teacher and as a parliamentarian is that science is absolutely critical to the understanding of our knowledge. And what the Curriculum for Excellence ought to be able to do, because it is built on the principles of expanding that knowledge, is to ensure that all youngsters have the ability to study in the arts, in the sciences, and in the social sciences. And I think, personally, that is absolutely the right way to approach the school curriculum. Sadly, because of some of the problems that we've got in the education system just now, that is not the case. And one of the huge difficulties, Mr. Kerr referred to this, Mr. Mara referred to this, is that we've got significant difficulties of teacher numbers in the sciences and the STEM subjects. But it's more than that. It's also about the fact that many young people are not getting the opportunity to study science because of the squeeze on subject choice. And that is a major, major issue. Because you cannot expect people to take up the subject if they're not getting the right exposure in the young years. And I thought Michelle Thompson, who's disappeared somewhere, was making a very strong point about nursery education as well. Because the stereotypes that Audrey referred to is absolutely clear. There are stereotypes, and that's something that we cannot allow to happen. So I think if we want to make sure that Scotland remains open for business in this respect, I think there's an awful lot that we have to do, both in the educational sense, but I also think there's an awful lot that we can do, and I would lay the challenge to Westminster Government to ensure that the visa system that we have is much more open than the one that has been put forward post-Brexit. Because in my view, there are too many circumstances where young people who are the meat and drink of our future are being prevented from taking up opportunities in this country because of too tight a visa system. So I'd like to see something go back. Yes, of course. Have I got time?
Stephen Kerr.
Do you also agree that there is a very strong case for expanding the postgraduate visa work visa programme because we want some of those people to stay here and make their futures in our own country?
Liz is absolutely right. I'd like to see us go back to the post-study work visa system where we are encouraging people to stay in this country and to take the opportunities of expanding their expertise as they are part of this system, because I don't think we're doing enough on that. I just want to finish on a point that I think is crucially important. Scotland has actually always led the world when it comes to women in science. Sadly, it's only very recently that that has been recognised and honoured in some cases. But we need to do an awful lot more to treasure what these women can give to our society. And I think we all have a role as parliamentarians to make sure that that happens. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Smith. And I call Cocab Stewart to be followed by Claire Baker. Around 4 minutes, Ms Stewart.
Thank you. In 2018, that's correct, 2018, during a workshop on gender equality at the CERN Research Institute in Geneva, Switzerland, theoretical physicist Alessandro Strumia began his presentation. On one of the slides was a very short but very powerful quote, and it read, "Physics was invented and built by men. It is not by invitation." According to reports, Professor Strumia went on to present evidence in the forum of graphs and tables, concluding that since the most cited academic papers were disproportionately written by men, this proved that men were simply better at physics. For a predominantly female audience full of young prospective scientists, I imagine that this was not quite the motivational speech that they were anticipating. And for women already working in the field, it would likely have felt very sadly familiar. The professor's claims were quickly dismantled and denounced as unacceptable, and he was suspended by CERN. The following day, Donna Strickland was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics for her pioneering work with high-intensity lasers. Astrophysicist Andrea Ghez would receive the same honour just 2 years later, for providing the first conclusive experimental evidence that a supermassive black hole with the mass of 4 million suns sits at the side of our galaxy. Incredibly, these are two of only four women who have ever won this prize in its 121-year history. So clearly, the question is not one of ability. Rather, this statistic is emblematic of a centuries-long struggle for recognition and the obstacles women and girls face at every point in their career which contribute to their underrepresentation across the scientific disciplines. In acknowledgement of this uneven landscape, the United Nations International Day for Women and Girls in Science on the 11th of February provides a welcome opportunity to celebrate the essential contributions that they have made and will continue to make, enabling us to better understand the world we live in. In my constituency, I'm incredibly fortunate to have internationally renowned higher and further educational institutes, and I'm grateful for the commitment that they have demonstrated, and I'm also grateful for colleagues across the Chamber that have mentioned Glasgow University, for instance. And I recognise and would like to recognise their demonstration to promoting gender equality in science as supported by the Scottish Funding Council and the development of tailored gender action plans. I will.
Stephen Kerr.
Co-cab Stewart to comment on what we saw in Buchanan High School on Monday, because Co-cab Stewart and Stephanie Gallagher. Stephanie. We went to the school with the education committee, and they had a huge display about women in science. And it's that kind of emphasis and that kind of promotion of women in science that will lead to those places that, Co-cab's just describing in these higher educational institutions being filled by women.
Co-cab Stewart, and I can give you the time back.
Thank you. I absolutely accept that from Stephen Kerr. To have that visual, very powerful image in our schools up and down the country reminds our children of what they're aiming for and the fact that we need them. Thank you for highlighting that. I would like to refer to Glasgow College, pioneering women into engineering courses, which have resulted in almost 100% increase in participation in engineering programmes, and the college's STEM Girls Society, which creates and encourages spaces for female students to meet and share ideas. At the University of Glasgow, former student turned lecturer in computing science, Dr. Sofiat Alicia Bickin, was selected as one of the university's future world changers for founding the Computer Science Academy Africa. This initiative delivered successful computer programming workshops in Nigeria and Rwanda, providing young Africans in STEM with access to quality computer science education. And women are strongly encouraged to apply here and are offered the possibility of childcare support. As a result, in 2022, 45% of CSA Africa participants were women. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, perhaps what's most challenging for us all is that we must work to recognise also our own unconscious biases and create an inclusive environment for the next generation of female scientists. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Stuart. Stuart, I now call Claire Baker to be followed by Willie Coffier in 4 minutes, Ms Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So ahead of International Day of Women in Science, we celebrate the achievements of generations of female scientists in Scotland, including the notable contribution of Burnt Island's Mary Somerville. The term scientist was coined to describe her many achievements in chemistry, astronomy, magnetism and mathematics, and her remarkable and inspiring work is rightly celebrated. But while we recognise the huge contribution of women to scientific discovery and research, we know that we are still not doing enough to ensure that women and girls are able to pursue careers in scientific fields. We need to do more to encourage and support this, but we also need to address the existing structures that deter women from doing so. We also need to see changes at every level, from schools to further and higher education and into workplaces. Boys and girls start with equal interest and ability in STEM areas, but women only make up 25% of the Scottish STEM sector. At every stage of the pathway, from school to work, there is attrition of females. Women are being stopped from achieving their full potential, and we fall short of the economic potential that only a diverse STEM sector can bring. So we need to ensure more girls are choosing STEM subjects, and that we have enough teachers to deliver the courses, that pupils do not end up having their choices taken away from them. Issues with teacher recruitment are not unique to STEM subjects, though uptake of those subjects is at a 5-year low. Across the curriculum, there are examples of subjects struggling to recruit, and this directly impacts on pupils as they are either left to, they're unable to pursue the subjects, or they're in classes without specific subject teachers, which in turn impacts on absenteeism and attainment. We also cannot have girls being steered away from science and technology subjects because they are male subjects. It is unfortunate there are still reports of this happening. We need to address this both in the way departments run themselves, but also in the discussions that take place with careers advisors and others. And while there are noted issues with uptake, we do have some schools who are bucking these trends, where there are high numbers of girls choosing technology subjects, with departments who do encourage them and cultivate an environment they are welcomed into, which other schools should be learning from. While we continue to encourage girls into STEM subjects at school and beyond, there is a cultural challenge for all STEM departments. They are male-dominated and can be a challenging environment for girls and women to be in. The Minister highlighted successful women in science, but girls and women should not be achieving in STEM subjects despite the barriers. The barriers must be removed. The debate briefing from the Royal Society of Chemistry talks of a leaky pipeline through the education pathway. Chemistry does have a high level of females studying the subject at school compared to other STEM subjects, but there's a steady decline in the proportion of women in chemistry departments as we move from undergraduate to postgraduate to staff and to professors. The RSC has identified some of the issues that need to be addressed to remedy this, and certainly many will be common across the STEM subjects. They point to themes including the rigidity of academic funding structures and working options, exclusionary behaviour, bullying and harassment. The gender pay gap is clearly still in place and emerges as early as the first year after graduation, despite figures showing that at this point, women are more likely to be retained in employment. This retention falls away over time, and those women who do remain are much less likely to hold a permanent contract. By 2019, the 2019 survey by Equate Scotland found that 64% of women who work or had worked in STEM didn't feel enough was being done to create inclusive workplaces or education institutions. Over Christmas, I read the book Lessons in Chemistry by Bonnie Garmas. I'm a STEAM graduate rather than a STEM graduate. This is a novel that's set in the 1950s, and it is disappointing to see that the issues explored in this novel of sexism, harassment, exploitation and underemployment for women working in science are still relevant today. Across the STEM subjects, we need to see action on the areas that the RCS and Equate Scotland highlight. We need continued work to eliminate bias and to increase accountability. We need to ensure that STEM courses and workplaces are inclusive and welcoming. And to do this, we need to see intervention and support at all levels. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Baker. I now call Willie Coffey to be followed by Claire Adamson. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Coffey.
Thanks very much. Presiding Officer, I'd like to start also by celebrating the achievements and successes of women in science, some of whom were pioneers in the field of computer science, my own area of interest that still sees far too few women studying it and going on to carve out a career in it. Perhaps the earliest of these was Ada Lovelace, who was born in 1815 and is regarded as the world's first computer programmer, who worked on Charles Babbage's analytical engine and devised what we think is the world's first algorithm or set of rules, now known as a computer program. The programming language Ada was named after her. I'd like to also mention Margaret Hamilton, possibly never mentioned in the Scottish Parliament before. Margaret was one of NASA's chief programmers for the Apollo program in the 1960s, and there's a famous picture of her as a young woman standing beside a huge printout of her computer programs that were actually taller than her. She coined the term software engineer, and she's still working today. And of course, a local success story, Presiding Officer, has to be Professor Victoria Martin from Kilmarnock, who has done some incredible work on the Higgs boson. And colleagues will remember that. The so-called God or creation particle that lends other particles their mass. So what do these women have in common? I'm prepared to stick my neck out and say that none of them, certainly not the first two, had any exposure to the types of initiative that we're deploying today to bring more young women into science. I'm prepared to bet that they all had something else in common. Curiosity. Curiosity mixed with ability and the opportunity, of course, that kept them on the pathway to their glittering careers. There's no doubt that there are a number of initiatives ongoing to attract more young women into science and to retain them, and they will make a difference to a degree. But we can all see the stats for ourselves, and they haven't really changed too much over the years. For example, only 20% or 23%, as Michael Mara reported, of the tech workforce in Scotland are actually women. Now, that's 3% higher than it is in England, but it's still miles too low. Only 21% of the graduate apprentices studying a STEM-related framework are women, and female college enrolments in STEM in Scotland have barely exceeded 30% since 2016. But we've got to keep working on it. So is there another solution? Is it more money? Is it new initiatives? Is it more equality in gender work, apprenticeships, equal pay, career progression issues, more science or computer science at schools, more teachers? Is it all of these? Perhaps it is. But I'm not so sure it explains why young women in particular walk away from science. When youngsters are still at primary school, I'm prepared to stick my neck out again and say that boys and girls are equally interested in science at primary school. And Claire Baker mentioned this. But when the transition to secondary school gets underway, the fall-off begins in terms of young women sticking with science, and it tends not to recover. So why don't we think of some other initiatives alongside what we have and see if it works? How about female-only science classes at school? Would that work? Maybe with female-only science teachers? Just for that vital couple of years, presiding officer, to try and keep the young girls inside that science bubble. I'm sure we can also find female role models, and Michelle Thompson mentioned that, who are in science today, to come in and enthuse those young women about the wonderful careers ahead of them. Can we do further things to incentivise employers to build up their intake of female scientists? And the Minister mentioned that in his opening speech too. And importantly, can we make sure that a career in science for young women doesn't mean them sacrificing lifestyle and other choices that are important to them? When you look around Europe, presiding officer, participation rates by women in IT are all on the low side, with Ireland and Lithuania being the highest at 32%, down to France at 24%, but all of them are ahead of Scotland at 20%. We've still got 24,000 IT vacancies in Scotland. Presiding officer, I sincerely hope we can make some big changes that we might one day celebrate this 50-50 representation of women and girls in all branches of science. After all, it's long overdue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Coffey. I can advise the Chamber that we now have exhausted all the time we have in hand, so I would invite members to stick to their speaking allocations, even if they're taking an intervention. With that, I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Maggie Chapman for up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I think at the start of my speech today, I would like to express my solidarity from the Chamber with those women and girls throughout the world who are denied education, particularly the women in Iran at the moment. We've been reflecting on some anecdotes from when we were younger. I wasn't going to actually put this in my speech, but when I went into my first O-grade physics class as the only girl in the class, the teacher said to me, "What are you doing here? Girls don't belong here." And if Mr. Rennie, I can only answer this from me, but why did I stay in that environment? Well, I'm just thrown, which he probably knows that by now as well. But it was quite challenging. And when I chose to study computing science as I did at university, I had three options. I could have gone to Glasgow University. There were three of us, three women that would have been in my year, or to Strathclyde, again, less than 10% women. I chose to do one of the first degrees at what was then Glasgow College, but became now Caledonia University. It was a four-year degree, not with honours, but a year in industry. And there was a 50-50 intake of women and girls. And to me, it just felt much more comfortable. And I've never regretted that decision because it taught me a lot about pathways into careers, about how apprenticeships, work experience and a different approach can make all the difference. Can I say to my colleagues as well over here, I studied economics for 2 years as part of that degree, so it was quite a different approach. And I think what we've heard about unique and different approaches to encouraging women is really important. So I am a member of the British Computer Society, and I draw my chambers to my register of interest as the Vice Chair of the Scottish Schools Education Research Centre, CERC, which means I'm also one of those women that are part of the leaky pipe, from the RSE's Tapping All Our Talents report, which has been covered in detail and covers some of the challenges for maintaining a career in science going forward. Indeed, that report quotes that only 27% of women who are graduated to degree level in STEM subjects still remain in those disciplines. Yesterday evening, I hosted the RSE and Physiological Society in the Garden Lobby and was delighted to see a project called Science Travels, an outreach programme to hard-to-reach groups from the Traveller, Showman and Boater communities. And I think this was really important because they have been highlighting that not only is diversity necessary, but it actually improves our collaboration and our thinking and our scientific investigations. And indeed, if we are to look to the challenges facing society in terms of the big challenges of climate, of migration, changing demographics, older populations. If we are truly to challenge these well, we have to have groups and minds that represent all of us and all of our communities involved in that. I was glad to hear people talk about the importance of teaching in this, and indeed CERC run the STEM Ambassadors and STEM Leaders programme, which are incredibly important for giving young women confidence to be able to go and talk and to lead in their areas. And quickly running out of time, but I want to highlight one totally inspiring teacher, Tony Scullion, who started the Social Enterprise Dress Code and runs coding classes for young women throughout Scotland and is award-winning in her endeavours. And it just, to me, highlights how important it is, inspiring teachers are, if we're to inspire future generations of women and girls in science. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank all those organisations who provided briefings and information for today's debate, because it is so important that we recognise the International Day of Women and Girls in Science, which takes place on Saturday. I want to recognise this day by talking about three women in science. They all have some things in common. They are all from the global north. They are all white. They all recognise the realities of climate change. The name and career of one you will know very well, the other two perhaps not. Eunice Newton Foote was born in the United States in 1819 and studied at the Troy Female Seminary. In 1856, she wrote a groundbreaking paper on the absorption of heat by carbon dioxide, suggesting that changes in its atmospheric concentration might change the climate of the Earth. 3 years later, John Tyndall, the so-called father of climate science, published similar observations. Did he know of Foote's work? We cannot tell. If he did, he didn't credit it. But it would not be the first nor the last time that a man took credit for work built on that a woman had done. In 1947, a young chemistry graduate, Margaret Roberts, began her first job at British Zylonite Plastics. Like many sensible workers, she joined a union. As Education Secretary and Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher oversaw the reshaping of university research by market forces. Now, in our universities, we see an obsession with ratings, exploitative publishing and exploited staff, obscene wage inequalities, and waste of time, of money, of energy, of goodwill, and of hope. But we also see dedicated scientists doing vital and inspiring work. That is a tribute to the researchers themselves, but also to all the staff and students who make up a university community. We stand in solidarity with them, and perhaps particularly today with UCU and their campaign to close the gender, ethnicity and disability pay gaps, and especially with the Unite and Unison workers at Dundee University, very many of them women, who refuse to be browbeaten into giving up their hard-won, long-promised, well-deserved and extremely modest pensions. For the women on those picket lines, many of them scientists, working on some of the most crucial crises of environment and health, Margaret Thatcher is no role model. But Eunice Foote, who campaigned for the abolition of slavery and for women's rights, she is a role model, and there are others. Professor Julia Steinberger has been a lead author on the IPCC Sixth Assessment Report, painstakingly communicating the realities of climate science to those who would much rather not hear. But that isn't enough. Last year, she took part in a campaigning road blockage in Bern, gluing her hand to the pavement. And in 2021, she co-wrote an academic article challenging universities to open up their ivory towers, to allow and to encourage advocacy and activism in the climate and ecological emergencies. That is science. That is academic excellence and responsibility. And that is feminism too. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, it matters that girls learn STEM subjects, that young women study science, that graduate women take their places in academia and industry. It matters that men get used to having women working alongside them, even leading them in STEM. And it matters what women do when they get into academia and industry. Margaret Roberts made a wise decision when she joined a union. Margaret Thatcher made another when she acknowledged the scientific reality of climate change. But Eunice Foote and Julia Steinberger and generations of scientists after them, including those who have given time to speak at the ongoing XR Dundee Science Talks, they have done better. They have maintained solidarity. They have retained compassion. They have shown courage and they have told the truth. That is why we need women and girls in science. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Chapman. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Fiona Hislop, up to 4 minutes, Mr. Kerr.
We need women and girls in science, and I couldn't quite work out whether Maggie Chapman was paying an uncharacteristic tribute to Margaret Thatcher or not, but let me be clear, I do in the context of the subject of this debate, because she was not only the first woman Prime Minister, but she was the first scientist to become a Prime Minister. And the fact she was the first woman scientist to become a Prime Minister is in itself astonishing. And quite right, as Maggie Chapman said, she was a very early warning voice on the dangers of climate change. So there's much to be said in praise of Margaret Thatcher in the context of the subject of this debate. But I hope we all felt, perhaps, the kick in the stomach that Willie Rennie inadvertently gave us when he revealed the statistics I was inquiring of the minister. 8% of women in those apprenticeships, engineering apprenticeships, is really shameful. And it shows how much more we have to do. There is a huge public policy interest in this area. We've had public policy interests in relation to equality, equal pay. We have a public policy interest in terms of the gender pay gap. We should absolutely and unreservedly have a public policy interest in the area of equalising the representation of women in vitally important fields, such as those represented by the subjects that we call STEM. Now, it's part of my political ethos that education is key. It is the golden ticket. It is about maximising potential. And we need to provide equality of opportunity for every young person, male and female, in our nation, regardless of where they live, what their background is, or the sex. They have to be able to feel empowered. We want them to feel empowered in respect to the pursuing their personal destiny. And to meet the needs of a vibrant and rapidly changing economic environment, the one that we live in now, we must develop the breadth and the depth of knowledge and skills within our workforce. And that absolutely must include the talent, the drive, the creativity, and the toughness of women to be able to get these things properly done. And so I would, in the time that I have, just wish to say a couple of things, really. And one is that we absolutely must tackle this underrepresentation of women in these critical sectors of our economy because, as I say, we are missing out massively. This is not a particularly Scottish problem, so we can all work together across boundaries and across parties, as I think is being evidenced by the tone of the debate this afternoon to that end. Let me say something about other things that have been said by colleagues. Yes, we can talk about the past. We've had some wonderful examples of the past. I've got one here in my speech notes, which I'm not going to use. The reality is that when you ask Scots to identify famous inventors, scientists, and engineers, they generally tend to be all men. And that has to be addressed. And that's why I brought up the example of Buchanan High School. We need to teach our young people from the very earliest possible age about the fact that great advances in the fields of science and engineering and achievement are equally the field of women as they are men. I wanted to comment on something Liz Smith said about broad general education. The reality is that when it comes to art subjects, we're not bad at giving young people opportunities to be in touch with different subjects. We are less good at that when it comes to STEM subjects. In fact, we've already rehearsed the issues surrounding STEM. They have to be addressed. If Scotland is to be a competitive economy, if we're to achieve the transformation that we all in this chamber want to see our Scottish economy achieve, then we absolutely must deliberately, as a matter of public policy objective, change the scene when it comes to the availability of STEM teachers and STEM subjects for our young people. In broad general education, yes, but also in terms of those who are presented at higher advanced. I will conclude And I will conclude by simply saying to the Minister, Minister, I've got one ask to make of the Minister, Presiding Officer, and that is that later this year we will have a historic event in Shetland. We will have a vertical launch of a rocket that's going to go into space. I remember, as a boy, being assembled in our primary school to watch the launch of the QE2 from Clydebank, and there was a lot of excitement about all of that. Would it be possible, Minister, for every Scottish
schoolchild
to be able to see a live broadcast of that rocket launch to excite them about what can be achieved in the name of science and progress?
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call Fiona Hislop, the final speaker in the open debate.
Education activist Malala Yousafzai said, if people were silent, nothing would change. Now, this statement rings true when we consider access to education for girls. Marking this International Day gives us the opportunity to highlight women and the work they are doing, but also areas where more needs to be done. This year's theme is IDEA, Innovate, Demonstrate, Elevate, Advance. In my own area, West Lothian College ran a successful Women in STEM course, encouraging and enabling more women to enter this field. And last weekend, the Enigmas, a group from Linlithgow Academy, took part in the Cyberfest Girls competition. Of course, Article 26 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights states everyone has the right to education. However, this right is not guaranteed for all girls. In Afghanistan, Taliban rulers ordered an indefinite ban on university access for women just in December. An outrage, and this chamber must stand in solidarity and express our condemnation at this outrage. In Burkina Faso, only 1% of girls complete their secondary education, and according to UNICEF figures, 129 million girls across the globe are not in school. In Iran, the Women Life Freedom protests are focused on women's rights and began in September 2022, following the death of Mahsa Amini, who died in police custody. And I want today in Parliament to pay tribute to all those who have been injured and killed in these protests. Women in Iran can and do study STEM subjects at both school and university level. In fact, in 2014, the late Iranian mathematician Mariam Mirzakhani became the first female to win the prestigious Fields Medal. In 2020, while celebrating International Day of Women and Girls in Science, UN Women named Mirzakhani one of seven women scientists who have changed the world. However, women and girls in Iran face inequalities which are a barrier to their education. A 2022 report from the United Nations Special Rapporteur on Human Rights in Iran stated the need to repeal laws that violate the rights of women and girls, to take measures to advance women's equal participation in public life, and to ratify the Convention of the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. Women in Iran face several barriers to receiving an education, including strict dress codes, rules which impact on all aspects of their public lives, including study, work, and leaving their home. Iran's laws restrict their careers that women can enter and deny equal benefits to women in the workplace. Women are not permitted to travel abroad for work or study without the permission of their male guardian. Internet access is intermittent, restricting online study and work for women and girls across the country. And according to World Bank statistics, women only account for 15% of the labour force in Iran. In a letter published in Chemical and Engineering News in October 2022 and signed by 104 Iranian chemists from across the globe, a call for solidarity with the women's movement in Iran was unmistakable. The letter also highlighted the lack of access to STEM subjects for women and girls in Iran and the departure of highly educated Iranians from the country over the years, including the late Mariam Mirzakhani, who I mentioned earlier. To advance women and girls in STEM internationally, we must not only support those entering this field, but also call out human rights violations which prevent women and girls from entering this area of study. Women in Iran and Afghanistan need all of us to stand in solidarity with them and to condemn the abuse of rights against them. So let's not be silent. Let us all be inspired by the words of Malala and use our voices to fight for the right to education for women and girls across the globe as we mark International Day of Women and Girls in Science.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and I frequently stand and thank the previous speaker because it is courteous to do so. But on this debate, can I thank Fiona Hislop for an incredibly powerful speech that talks actually to the heart of what Saturday's International Day is about. It is about standing up for the human rights of women, of girls, so that they can hopefully develop or already are very powerful scientists and human beings. And it was a very powerful speech, and can I thank her for that. It has been a good debate. It has been a debate of much consensus, and it has been a debate that I think actually reflects the views of Scotland, which is one of the reasons, of course, for the institution in which we stand here today. I would like to make mention of Audrey Nicholls' speech, and in particular her reference to the Shell Company's project of Girls in Industry. And I think it speaks a tribute to there is 100 girls being involved, fighting views about an industry that they have perhaps grown up with a male-dominated view of it, when actually the reality is so very different. And I think it is a true testament both to Shell and to the accompanying college that they're able to do this. And it allows me to make reference also to Michelle Thompson's few interventions with regard to the importance of role models from at a nursery level, where I can say from experience, I see all children performing great science, be it in the mud kitchen, be it outside, be it with Lego. And those powerful examples that they have of working together to solve problems lies at the heart of what STEM is about. It is about approaching something in a different way to other people to solve that. And that difference is just as relevant in women and girls as it is in men and boys. And we simply remove 50% of those people who could solve the problems by ignoring that when we crowd out, push out, persuade, gently condone with maths is not for women, away from a very important problem-solving area that, quite frankly, across the whole world, we lack that scientific thinking in so many places. I would like to mention Liz Smith's speech because of her powerful discussion. We heard from a number of people about the difficulty in teacher numbers, which I think we have to accept here in Scotland, and particularly in STEM, and the interesting contributions about whether or not we can change that. But the need that this country, that human beings have for a balanced curriculum, so as they go through their childhood, they experience a vast and wide variety of influences, ideas. They learn new facts. They learn new approaches, because only in that way can an individual celebrate their thinking patterns and be able to contribute so fully later on in life. And indeed, having been a teacher, young people contribute so strongly to adults learning and understanding a situation. I think it's worth mentioning Claire Baker's speech because she talked about that leaky pipeline. We have been aware of this, frankly, for decades, but are we any better at plugging those leaks? I would suggest that we're not, and I think one of the challenges is that perhaps we are looking at it the wrong way. We have heard many, many examples today of individual women who have strived and achieved so much, and some people have posed the question, why were they able to do it? And I think we don't know the answer, but what we do have, and we've also heard today, of the very great examples of schools that have a greater number of girls taking science than others. We should look to the success out there and try and replicate it, expose our teachers, expose our policymakers to the very best, as indeed Stephen Kerr mentioned about visiting the school where he saw the display with regard to female scientists. We need to treasure what works so well, allow others to see it and replicate it. And I would suggest to Mr. Kerr that perhaps his question, if you ask about a scientist, you only get a man, probably depends on the age of the person that you ask that question of. I would also like to very quickly make mention, I am conscious of time, about Claire Adamson and her individual choice to go to an institution where there was a 50-50 balance to take there. And I think that speaks powerfully of the desire that individuals have. And that speaks powerfully of what the responsibility of this place, and indeed the Scottish Government and other governments are, is to ensure that happens. I have a very quick question for the Minister with regard to the STEM education and training strategy. I could say I'm disappointed at only the one reference to a girl in it, or only the five references to women in it. I think when we talk about changing the fundamentals, we should think about that in everything we do. But I would like to ask about the STEM Strategy Implementation Group minutes, last published on March 2020 from a meeting in September, and I would be grateful for an update of when they have most recently met, and indeed whether it will continue to meet going forward. I think this has been a very...
The member really must conclude, so I would ask, Minister, if you could respond when...
And on that point, I will conclude to allow for an answer from the Minister in due course. I'm grateful, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call on Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be closing today's debate for the Scottish Conservatives, which marks the International Day of Women and Girls in Science, for a number of reasons. Firstly, I was fortunate enough to have two female science teachers at school, and I'll dedicate that to them. Mrs Moog, who sadly is no longer here, she was chemistry, and Mrs Rowley Walton, who may just be watching, who knows. Another reason is that I am a life science graduate from the University of Edinburgh in biochemistry, and fortunately, due to the comments that Jamie Hepburn made, it's no longer 1896, and I was able to graduate quite successfully. What I learned then is now most likely taught at school, however, as the understanding of the workings of the cell has progressed rapidly since then. Imagine a time when every lab did not have a PCR machine, gene editing tools such as CRISPR did not exist, whole genome sequencing took years, and fluorescent microscopy was only just becoming commercialised. Doing quality science under those conditions was archaic, but that's what we were doing back then. The adaptation of new tools for simple and affordable use has increased the speed of research, and looking back 20 years reveals just how far we've come in terms of technology, but sadly not in terms of gender equality in the science world. While improvement has been made increasing the number of women in STEM subjects, I think we have all agreed that more progress must be made as the STEM sector is still dominated by men. My colleague Pam Gossel mentioned that there is a big gender gap in science, women just making up 7% in STEM apprentices in training and women making up only a quarter in the STEM sector. Entries in science subjects by women are also at their lowest level in 5 years at both national five and higher level. And Michael Mara, and many members to be fair, also spoke about this leaky talent pipeline that occurs across our careers from as early as school all the way through to our advanced science careers. And I'm a scientist, and I'm probably a leaky pipeline then, because I'm now a politician. Claire Adamson, much could be the same for ourselves. So it's very, very clear that there's an ongoing struggle to attract and keep young women and women and girls to study STEM subjects and pursue those careers. However, even when they're successful at attracting women into the sector, there are issues, as we've said, in retaining that female talent. The Royal Society of Chemistry has statistics that show in 2021 more than 60% of accepted applicants to the university chemistry courses in Scotland were female, the highest figure of all the UK nations, which is laudable, but not good enough. Yet we only have 9% of professors, and we've heard about the Google professors, and you have, I think that was from Audrey Nicholl, the page of grey, dark-haired men appearing on our screens, which isn't quite what we like to imagine. Scotland's schools play that vital role in ensuring that our STEM subjects are available to young women and encouraging young women to consider careers in science. I wasn't able to do all three sciences at the same time. I did do all three sciences, but staggered. And I even helped a constituent recently be able to study all three sciences at the same time, but she had to move schools to do so. We need to get better at that. There are fewer science, maths, physics and computer science teachers in 2021 than in 2008. And these are the careers, and I'm trying to get my words right on this. You know, computer science is the future. We don't know what these young people are going to be taking up careers in, but understanding programming and computers is the way forward. We have to have more of these teachers. My colleague Liz Smith made quite a contribution regarding the seven ladies of Edinburgh Medical School that was quite spine-tingling in terms of, you think of the way she animated that. It was great. But she also mentioned that in 2015, the Royal Society of Chemistry made the call to have dedicated science teachers in every primary school. And this is something I would also support when you consider that gender inequality in participation in science and other STEM subjects starts at a very young age. And while we commend the improvements in getting women into STEM, there are still massive improvements to be made, and there is not that much progress being made by this SNP government. And Martin Whitfield made reference to the fact that so few references to women are in that documentation. We have to set the example. We're the leaders in this, and it's up to us to make sure that we're presenting a world in our strategies and policies that young women can aspire to be part of. Scotland is a home to world-leading organisations in science, and we've heard many of those examples today. Last year, I visited Q2 Solutions, which is a leading clinical laboratory service in West Lothian, and it was a senior female friend of mine that was my link into that organisation, Maggie Conacher. Another shout out to Maggie. Later this month, I will be visiting the National Robototerium, which has unrivalled facilities and world-leading expertise in robotics and artificial intelligence, and that's out at the Heriot Watt University. And I also took part in an Innovating Scotland Healthcare Roundtable alongside remarkable women, including Dame Anna Dominicza, I'm not very good at these, a Polish-born medical researcher who's now our chief medical officer. We should be actively encouraging young women to study these subjects and pursue these sorts of careers every single day. The Scottish Conservatives would fully fund the placement of dedicated STEM teachers in every primary school. And we want to restore excellence in Scottish schools so that every child has the chance to succeed, no matter their background. And we will be supporting all of the amendments and motions today. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to wind up. Up to 8 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I thank all members who've contributed? We have, over the course of this afternoon, heard a range of contributions that have enabled us to reflect on the many achievements of women in science across Scotland, and I'm really pleased that colleagues have been able to highlight so many examples of the various female science pioneers in Scotland. I have to say I've felt some degree of inadequacy by comparison to some colleagues. We have a number who are qualified and have formally practised in the STEM professions, and to those members in particular, I have to say it's great that they have contributed, because they themselves are able to be pointed at as role models for the professions they have been involved in. We also heard Stephen Kerr's request of me regarding the rocket launch from Shetland. I was a bit concerned as to where he was taking it. I thought he might be suggesting it should be tied to the rocket, but he didn't go there. I would certainly commend to our schools to give their young people the chance to watch that event. I can actually say there is activity underway in the coming period ahead. Education Scotland will be engaging with local authorities, with schools and with other partners to see what activities can be undertaken around that launch to try and inspire young people. So just to reassure Mr Kerr in that sense. As much as we've heard and we've rightly spoken about the many successes, much of the debate has focused on some of the challenges we face. And I don't shy away from the fact that there are challenges. Stephen Kerr was right to say that it's not a uniquely Scottish problem, but we do have to take them head on. If ever there was a reminder, though, about the international context in which we operate, and I must mention this, it was Fiona Hislop's contribution. She spoke about some of the deep-seated, outright discrimination that exists for women and young girls in other parts of the world, Firth of Scotland, not as historic examples as both I and Liz Smith were able to reflect on in relation to the Edinburgh Seven, but in the here and now. And I think it is important, Presiding Officer, that we say with one voice, loudly and clearly, that here in Scotland we fundamentally believe in the right to an education, including the STEM subject matter, for every young girl and woman in the world. That is something that we absolutely believe in. Can I turn to the issue of STEM teachers that was mentioned? I do recognise that we have a challenge here. I should say, Frank, I think this is symptomatic of the wider labour market challenge that we face right now. Those who are qualified in STEM are in great demand, including, it appears, to work in the political profession for some of them, but more widely, it is a challenge. But what we are doing is that we have the STEM bursaries in place to encourage people who've worked, who have that background of working in the STEM sector, to switch careers, switch profession, to come in to act as STEM teachers, and they themselves would be fantastic role models for the young people that they would end up acting as teachers for. I want to also pick up on the point that was made by Martin Whitfield in relation to the STEM Strategy Implementation Group and the STEM Strategy more widely. There was, of course, some disruption over the course of the COVID-19 period in terms of that group meeting. What I can say is the group has continued to provide and act as a source of invaluable advice and assistance to the government as we take forward the strategy. That strategy is coming to an end. We're considering the next steps as we move forward, but it is exactly that type of personnel that we rely on to continue to inform the work we undertake. And in relation to the point that both he and Sue Webber made, I will certainly reflect on the fact about the number of times women featured in the STEM strategy that we have been operating to. Very briefly, yes.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful the Minister to give way. And perhaps with the redevelopment of the implementation group, maybe a more gender balance on that group may find assistance to the Government.
Minister.
Just as I've said, I'll reflect on the wider point. I will reflect on that too. I think it is an eminently reasonable point to make. It turned to apprenticeships, which was mentioned in particular by Stephen Kerr and Willie Rennie, but by others as well. Having had the chance now to look out some of the figures, we do have a challenge, a significant challenge in terms of female participation in the relevant frameworks. The figures that I have would suggest that of the STEM modern apprenticeship frameworks in operation, there are around 11% of women taking part. That's wider than just the engineering framework that Willie Rennie mentioned, which is why it's a slightly different figure, but it's still far too low. I can say, and Willie Coffey mentioned this, that if, by comparison, if you look at graduate apprenticeships, the figure is in excess of that, at around 20%, 21.2%. That's an increase from when they were first put in place. Again, in the foundation apprenticeship frameworks, we have nearly a quarter of participants are young girls in the secondary school environment. That's still not good enough, but it does give us some optimism for the future that the numbers are higher at that young age. But we do need more progress in this area. That's why the SDS Equalities Action Plan is important. That's why the SAB, the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board recommendations are important. We will consider them. I will say our employers have a huge role to play in this regard. Apprenticeships are an employment opportunity, and it's up to employers to make sure that they're thinking through their recruitment practice when they take on apprentices as well. I'm pleased to say there are many employers that are actively engaged in thinking about how to do better in that regard. Role models was also the subject of some discussion. In fact, no, I'll come back to the role models issue in a minute, because I also wanted to pick up on Willie Rennie's point. He rightly identified the importance of the improving gender balance activity being taken forward by Education Scotland. I can assure him I do not want to see that lost through the process of reform that we're taking forward. In terms of role models, they are fundamentally important in terms of the activity that we take forward. We, of course, have the Scottish Schools Education Research Centre undertaking activity in that regard. Claire Adamson mentioned the Ambassadors programme. I'll be very interested to follow up on the innovative suggestion that was made by Michelle Thompson and intervention Audrey Nicholl about how we might do more and utilise female ambassadors better as part of that activity. And our developing young workforce activity can also play a role. Our science festivals funding is important in this regard as well. We provide £220,000 to support those festivals. As I mentioned earlier, I was in Dundee to see some of that activity, and I was very pleased to see that there were young girls engaged in that activity as well. And to Claire Adamson's point on Tony Scullion is part of the Scottish Teachers Computing Science activity, which is funded by the Scottish Government, which recently included a teacher upskilling programme. So that's some of the activity that is underway. This has been a useful opportunity for us to not only reflect on the many outstanding achievements of women scientists in Scotland, as we rightly should do, but also to recognise the challenges that still exist, Presiding Officer, and those are challenges that I think we are collectively determined to rise to.